So welcome to today's second lecture on this student training on artificial intelligence and machine learning. Now this lecture is on mathematical basics which might be used to study the different algorithms pertaining to AI and ML. And this is all about the linear algebra. And as I've already mentioned in the first lecture that since the population who are attending this particular training course is a heterogeneous one. So I'll be discussing something which is very fundamental, very basic one, so that it can be understood by almost all of you. So the foundation of this machine learning and AI systems wholly depends upon some mathematical principles and concepts. Initially, as I mentioned, the first stage of AI was influenced by some predicate logic influenced from philosophy. But later on, since there are two winters which have been experienced by the AI researchers in 1970s and 1980s, then the people from the computer science, they have come together with the AI people, and accordingly, some mathematical deliberations were made. Now I'll be discussing something which is very fundamental pertaining to this one. Before that, let me tell you what are the areas of linear algebra which are used in machine learning and artificial intelligence. So, areas to be discussed pertaining to AI and ML . So the first one is the very fundamental one, the vectors and the matrices. Which I believe that all of you have studied in the engineering mathematics course during your undergraduate study. Then the system of linear equation. System of linear equation. Right now, I'm just writing down the topics. Later on, when we'll be discussing about the different types of AI algorithms, then you can associate each and every such areas to those particular topics. Then the derivation of regression line. We'll be talking about the covariance matrix. The properties of convolution to some extent. And obviously, although I have planned to include this one as a separate unit, but still, for the sake of completeness, let me write it down. Support vector machine classification, which is in short known as SVM. And classification is an important part of of machine learning. I'll be discussing the introductory lecture on machine learning tomorrow. We'll see that support vector machine is playing an important role in classifying the objects. And might be something on dimension reduction through PCA. In fact, there are other areas as well, but I believe that it might not be completed within the short span of time. So these are some of the areas which have a strong dependence to artificial intelligence and machine learning. Now, let me start with the first one, that is on matrix. I hope that all of you have got sufficient knowledge on matrix, but still, as a matter of completeness, I need to discuss this one as the first technical lecture on this particular course, because the first lecture was an introductory lecture on the history of artificial intelligence. Well, as you know, so matrix is nothing but arrangement of numbers in rectangular form, and I can always represent this matrix by means of a, let us say, A in a rectangular form, just like this. So it's a brief recapitulation to all of you. So suppose there are k number of members like A11, A12 up to A1k in the first row. Then we have the second row, we have like A21, A22 up to A2k. And in this way, I can have, say, for example, j number of such rows, which leads to the complete rectangle. So I can say that, what is the dimension? The dimension of this particular matrix is nothing but j cross k. J cross k is the dimension, so it stores j cross k number of elements of data over here, and the number of rows and the number of columns is called the dimension of the matrix, as you know. And this dimensionality of the matrix is also called the order of a matrix. Now, if this j and k, they are not equal to each other, so in that case, I can say that it's a rectangular matrix. For example, if j is equal to 5 and k is equal to 6, then it's a matrix of order 5 plus 6. And in case j is equal to k, then it is known as a square matrix. So for j not equal to k, as you know, it's a rectangular matrix in general. Rectangular matrix. And for j equal to k, it's a square matrix. Now, from the matrix, we can derive a special kind of matrix, which is called a vector. So if I just extract one row or one column, then it is known to be a vector. So what is vector? So vector is nothing but a special kind of matrix, a special type of matrix. So vector is a special kind of matrix. So which have either one row or one column. So accordingly, I can have two different types of vector. either I can have a row vector. Or I can have what is known as a column vector. In other words, if I just combine row vector and column vector together in some order, then I can once again get back the original matrix. For example, I can derive, say, alpha, which is equal to say alpha 1, comma alpha 2, alpha 3, up to say alpha k. I can extract one row from a vector, from our matrix, and it will form a vector. And this vector is known as a row vector, since it has only one row. And I can always find out what is the dimension of this particular row vector. So one row I have, and I have k number of columns, so 1 plus k. Or I could have another vector like this, beta, which is like, say, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, up to, say, beta j. This is known to be a column vector. Which is having j number of rows and one columns. So the dimension will be j cross 1. So these are very fundamental one, this row vector, column vector, which are derived from the matrix itself. Then let me go to the next topic, that is the matrix addition. Now, the matrix addition, I can always add two matrices or more than two matrices if they are of the same order, as you know. Suppose I am having one matrix A, there is another matrix B. Now, if the dimension of these two matrices being the same, then only I can add them together or subtract one from the other. And the result is a new matrix AC. For example, let me consider two cos 2 matrix like this and another 2 cross 2 matrix like this. Then the addition is given by the third 2 cross 2 matrix. So element by element multiplication addition over here. A21 plus B21, and over here A22 plus B22. So the size being the same. So that I can write as C11, C12, C21, C22. As you know, this is the nomenclature to represent the defined elements. First row, first column, first row, second column, second row, first column, and second row, second column. Now at this juncture, let me remind you, because already you know this one, some important properties of matrix addition. Because this lecture is entirely a recapitulation, because I believe that since you are in second year or third year of your undergraduate course, so already you have studied matrix in one of your engineering mathematics class. So let me remind you some of the properties of matrix addition. The first property is of commutativity. That means if I add two matrices like A plus B, and if I change the order of addition, it will give us the same result. So this property is known as commutative property. Or I can say that matrix addition is commutative in nature. The second property is that of associativity. That means if I add to matrix X A plus B, and if I have a third matrix like C, obviously the dimension should be identical. Otherwise, I cannot add. So if I change the order of addition, so here I have changed the operators. I mean, A first and B second, here B first and A second. And here, A plus B first, then C, and here A first and then B plus C. So operators being the same here, the addition operation plus, now operands is the first operand and second operand, there has been change in the operands, and here the operation has been changed. Initially B and C, and then the result is added with A. Now if it holds good, then it is known as associative property, and which is intuitively satisfying. As you know, we go by the formula of matrix addition, that you find that these two properties hold good. Next, let me go to the transpose of a matrix. What do you mean by the transpose? Now, if the order subscripts are exchanged for each element of the matrix A, then you'll be getting the transpose version of that. For example, I can have one matrix, say A, now which belongs to, say, M cross N. R to the power m cross n. What does it mean? This is nothing but this R stands for the real number, and R to the power m cross n is nothing but the m cross n dimension of the real number, and A is a subset. So this R to the power m cross n is an m cross n dimensional set, and A is a subset of that. And let me consider another matrix B, which is a subset of real number set R n cross m. So as you understand that these two main sets are different. One is R to the power m cross n, and second one is R to the power n cross m. So A is a subset of this set, and B is a subset of the second set, with the condition that Aij is equal to Bji. And if this condition holds good, then I can say that the matrix B is the transpose of the matrix A, and vice versa. So that can be represented by B is equal to A transpose, or A is equal to B transpose. So how does it look like? Suppose A is given by this particular representation. Say A11, A12, up to say A1n. And here you have the different rows, ultimately the final row, AM1, AM2, then you have AMN. So this is the matrix A. Then A transpose is nothing but, so the rows are A is nothing but the column of A transpose, and vice versa. So one should write like this: A11, A12, A1n. And then the second row will be placed over here, and ultimately the final row. Amen. So here we find that the order is m cross n for the matrix A, And for the matrix A transpose, the order becomes n cross m. So the order of matrix m cross n has become n cross m for its transpose version. Now what happens for vector? Let me have a look. What happens for the vector transpose? If I have a vector like alpha, so I would like to talk about the vector transpose. If I have a row vector like this, say 1, 4, minus 5, 2, its transpose, alpha transpose, is given by, so since it's a row vector over here, alpha, with dimension 1 plus 4, so alpha transpose will be 4 plus 1, with this particular row is being represented as the column. So let me tell you some properties regarding the transpose. Some of the properties of matrix transpose, some properties I'd like to mention. The first one was that if we apply the transpose operation twice, or rather even number of times, not twice, to be generic, I should say even number of times, then I'll be getting the same matrix back. And the second property is something like that. A plus B transpose, if I add two matrices like this, this will give me A transpose plus B transpose. And the third property is like this. If I multiply constant, scalar constant, with a matrix, and if I take the transpose together, this gives me C into A transpose. Now sometimes we call that the matrix is symmetric in nature. So what do you mean by symmetric matrix? So a matrix is said to be symmetric. Said to be symmetric if the condition A equal to A transpose holds good. If the condition holds good that A is equal to A transpose, then one can say that the matrix is said to be symmetric in nature. Now let me go to the multiplication part, the matrix multiplication with a scalar first, and then the matrix multiplication with another matrix. So first I'll start with the matrix multiplication with a scalar. If I have a matrix like this, A, given by A11, A12, for example, I'm taking a 2 cross 2 matrix, A21, A22. Then alpha times A means each of the elements of the matrix A itself is multiplied by the same constant, that is alpha. This is alpha A. So alpha could have been anything, a positive number, a negative number, a fraction, it can be anything. So as long as we are dealing in the real number system, so alpha cannot be complex or imaginary, assuming that alpha is always a real number, maybe fraction, maybe positive, maybe negative. So for example, if I select that alpha is equal to say 0.5, then each element will be multiplied by 0.5, or rather it will be divided by 2. So alpha A will be something like that. So it can be anything, as you know. Just like this. So this is all about the matrix multiplication with the scalar. Now let us move to the matrix multiplication with another matrix. So this matrix multiplication is nothing but a dot product of rows and columns, where the row of the matrix is multiplied and summed up with another matrix column. So to ensure this one, the matching of the order of the matrix is also essential. Otherwise, you cannot multiply. So matrix multiplication with another matrix. In fact, matrix forms a very basic course on linear algebra, which has its strong dependence in particularly neural network. In neural network, when we'll be discussing about the different architectures of neural networks and the weights and all, you'll see that there are lots of matrices and lots of matrix operations being involved over there. So let me come back to the discussion itself, matrix multiplication with another matrix. Now this is only possible when the corresponding, I mean, you have a matrix like AM cross N. If you multiply this with another matrix whose dimension is N cross P only, then you can find out a resultant matrix C with a dimension M cross P. Otherwise, it is not at all possible to multiply two matrices. In general, I can write down that the individual element of this C matrix is given by Cij, which is nothing but summation over Aik into Bkj, where k is ranging from 1 to n. So this is the generic expression for each and every element of C, that is Cij. Now, I would like to mention by means of an example, say it is like minus 2, 1, and 3, and another one, the second row is given by 4, 1, and 6. So we have two row and three columns, so 2 cross 3. And let me have another matrix B. Obviously, the dimension should match accordingly. So let it be like 3 minus 2, 2, 4, and say 1 minus 3. If I multiply these two matrices together, A and B, what I will be getting? So first this minus 2 will be multiplied with 3. So I can write minus 2 into 3 plus 1 into 2 plus this 3 into 1 and the second element of this matrix will be minus 2 into minus 2 minus 2 will be multiplied with minus 2. And this is added to 1 into 4. And then we have 3 into minus 3. Similarly, if I perform the multiplication for the second row, it will be 4 plus 4 into 3, 1 into 2, 6 into 1 over here, 4 into minus 2, plus 1 into 4, plus 6 into minus 3. So ultimately, if we just calculate this one, so minus 6 and 3, 2, 5, so it will become minus 1, 4, 4, 4, 8, 8 and minus 9, that will be minus 1 again, 12, 12 plus 6, 8, 6 plus 2, 8, 20, minus 8, plus 4, minus 4, minus 4, minus 18, minus 22. So this is the resultant matrix, as you know very well. So matrix multiplication is only possible when the number of columns in the first matrix is equal to the number of rows in the second matrix. Now here also, there are certain properties to remember regarding the matrix multiplication. First of all, the scalar multiplication, if I just consider the scalar multiplication, so the scalar multiplication, you can check it. I'm just writing down the property itself. Scalar multiplication is commutative. I've already discussed what is meant by commutativity property. It's commutative, associative. And distributive. What do you mean by distributivity property? Distributive. That means if I multiply C A plus B, this is a multiplication. So this multiplication, scalar multiplication, is distributive or addition. So C into A plus C into B. However, you'll find that this matrix multiplication operation is not at all commutative. This is an important point to remember, that matrix multiplication is not at all commutative. First of all, you cannot multiply itself if the dimensions did not match. And even if we have a same dimension, like a square matrix, say of order n cross n, then also, if you perform A into B, this operation, and if you perform B into A, this operation, you'll find that this operation, I mean the final result, is not identical. You can carry out this operation. You'll see that A into B of equivalent dimension, that means both of them are having a dimension of n, n cross n rather, the order is n. And if you perform this one, A into B and B into A, in general, they are not same, except some special case. If I have identity matrix, then it will be same. Otherwise, it will not be same. Then we have this associativity property, which is obviously true. So matrix multiplication, that means matrix with matrix, matrix multiplication. Is associative in nature. Associative in nature. What does it mean? That means if I have two matrices like this, A and B, and if it is multiplied with C, and instead of doing that, if I multiply B and C first, and then I multiply the resultant matrix with A, I'll be getting the same answer. So it is associative. And obviously it is distributive. This matrix multiplication is distributive. That means multiplication is distributive over addition. This time, this is a matrix, not a scalar. But however, even for scalar multiplication, this distributive property holds good. So this is nothing but A into B plus A into C. And another interesting result, rather property, the transpose of a product. What happens for this? Transpose of a product. That means if I have two matrices like A and B, and if I find out the transpose of that, that is AB transpose, is it equal to A transpose and B transpose? Something different. This is basically given by B transpose multiplied with A transpose. And this is not exactly equal to A transpose into B transpose because the matrix multiplication is not at all commutative in nature. So these are some of the properties pertaining to matrix multiplication. Similarly, we can define the vector multiplication. So for vector multiplication, I can similarly write vector multiplication first. Let us define a column vector. Let a column vector be defined. Let it be E, which is given by, say, E1, E2, say up to EN. So the order is N plus 1, N row and one column. That is the order. Now the inner product of E is represented as follows. Inner product of E can be given by, this is nothing but E dash D. What is dash? Dash is nothing but the transpose operation, E dash D. So we have like over here E1, E2, EN as a row vector, and this one is the column vector E1, E2, EN. So here, what will be the dimension? Here, one row and n column, and here, n row and one column. If I multiply, the result will be a scalar quantity because the dimension will be 1 plus 1. So what is that? E transpose E, nothing but E1 multiplied with E1 plus E2 multiplied with E2 plus dot dot EN multiplied with EN. So it is nothing but summation EI squared for I ranging from 1 to n. So for inner product, you'll be getting a scalar quantity. Now, if I represent E as a signal, suppose these are nothing but the component of any signal, any sensory signal or any signal, then this particular operation, I'm representing the, say, the sample values of any signal. Perhaps you might not understand what is meant by the sample value of a signal. Suppose any, I am having one signal for which the sample values or the corresponding signal amplitudes are represented by like E1, E2, E3, and so on. So there are n samples to represent that particular symbol or signal. Then this particular operation, this E dashed into E, is nothing but summation I is equal to 1 to n EI square. This will give me the energy component or energy content within that particular signal. So just by representing the signals by means of a matrix or vector, and if I perform this inner product of this E, this will give me the energy content of that particular signal. So mathematically, it's nothing but a scalar quantity, but physically, if I want to associate these different elements of the vector, column vector E, like E1, E2, E3, as the signal amplitude of any sensory signal, of any signal, then the inner product will give us the energy content present within that particular signal. Now, apart from the inner product, we do have an outer product as well. And the outer product is given by, this is also true for the vector. So column vector, we have already defined a column vector E of dimension or order n plus 1. Now the outer product of E, so the outer product of E is denoted by E into E transpose, and which is having an order of n cross n, which is a matrix itself. So let us consider that I is nothing but a vector of ones of order n cross one. Suppose I'd like to represent I as a vector of ones. Vector of ones means all the elements of the matrix I is one vector of ones of order, say, m cross one. And x is a vector of data, any data I can consider, and the order being the same, m cross one. So in that case, if I calculate the inner product first, and with an average inner product, that means I dashed into x, and with an average outside, 1 by n, this will give me 1 by n, and since all the elements are 1 within the vector I, so eventually the elements of x vector will be added together, so x1, x2 up to xn. So mathematically, I can write this like 1 by n summation of xi, which is nothing but x bar or average signal component. And if I consider, instead of I, if I consider another vector, say y, and for which the order is not or it is n cross 1, but it is not a vector of ones. Y as another arbitrary vector. Arbitrary vector. Of order n cross 1. The only difference is that for y, the elements are not 1. Rather, I can have an arbitrary element over here. So that's the arbitrary vector. And if I perform this operation, inner product operation x dash y, so this will give me x1 y1 plus x2 y2 plus up to xn yn. So in general, I can write this expression as xi yi, and I is ranging from 1 to n. And this is a weighted average expression, and which is having its serious implication in neural network. While I'll be discussing about the neural network, you'll see that one element is, I mean, out of these two matrices, x and y, one matrix is that of the signal, the input signal, which you apply to the network itself. And the other vector, the arbitrary vector, which I have mentioned over here of order n cross 1, you'll find that that time the order might not be n cross 1, the order might be anything. But for the sake of simplicity, I've started with n cross 1. So you'll see that this arbitrary vector is nothing but the weights of the neural network. And ultimately, the output of the network from that layer is nothing but the weighted average. So that weighted average can be closely represented by means of the inner product of one vector with another vector, or one matrix with another matrix. So the concept of this matrix and vectors, they are having serious implication in artificial neural network, which will be delivered in one of the lectures of this particular course. Now we can also represent this matrix multiplication using vectors. For example, I can write this matrix multiplication. Suppose this is the matrix A11, A12, A13, and I have another matrix like A21. I mean, the second row is given by A21, A22, and A23. Now I do have another matrix over here for which the dimension is a bit different. Let it be B11, B12, B21, B22, and B31, B32. So I can represent this as by means of vectors only. Suppose, so to make sense, it's a vector. So let me use a different color so that you can understand that these are the vectors. Let it be A1 dashed and A2 dashed. And for this one, this matrix, I would like to represent by means of another vectors like B1 and B2. Then if I make any attempt to multiply A with B to give a new matrix, say C, I can always multiply these two together because we have 2 cross 3 over here, 2 row and 3 columns, and 3 cross 2 over here. So I can always multiply these two matrix together. So the point is that instead of multiplying with the individual element, I would like to multiply them with the corresponding vectors, which are associated with the individual elements. So that can be represented by this. A1 dash B1. Here you have A1 dash B2. Rather, I should use a different color to make sense that this is the same A1 or same A2. So this is a1 dash b1. This will be a1 dash b2. This is a2 dashed v1 and a2 dashed v2. So the matrix multiplication has been carried out by means of vectors only. Now we have talked about the square matrix. A square matrix is one for which the number of rows and number of columns are identical. Now a square matrix is known to be diagonal matrix where all the elements are zero except those on the main diagonal. What I mean to say is that a matrix A is said to be a square matrix if it belongs to, say, R n cross n. If it belongs to that particular set, then I can say that this is a diagonal matrix if and only if all the elements are zero except those on the main diagonal. So since it belongs to R n cross n, so obviously it's a square matrix. Now if I find that this Aij is equal to zero for all I not equal to j, for all I not equal to j, and if it is non-zero, any value for all I equal to j, if this condition holds good, I can say that it's a diagonal matrix. Then it is known as, when this condition holds good, then the square matrix is known to be a diagonal matrix. For example, I can write a diagonal matrix like this, a 3 cross 3 square matrix. Let it be like 1, 0, 0, then you have 0, 2, 0, and let we have 0, 0, 3. It's a diagonal matrix because the elements in the main diagonal are non-zero, and apart from that, the other elements are zero. So that's why it's a diagonal matrix. And from the diagonal matrix, so I can write that the square matrix is a big set. Suppose this is the set of square matrix. So this is square matrix. So in short, I should write SM, square matrix. Now, within this big set, I would have a small set of diagonal matrix. Let me write by DM, diagonal matrix. And a square matrix is known to be an orthogonal matrix if and only if its columns are orthonormal, which is known to be an identity matrix. So let me show you the identity matrix. How does it look like for a 3 cross 3 matrix? So this I can be represented by 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. It's a special kind of diagonal matrix. So we have identity matrix over here, IM for short. The square matrix is the superset. Within this, we have a subset of diagonal matrix. And within the diagonal matrix, we have another subset of identity matrix. Now, the identity matrix is commutative, associative, and distributive over with respect to multiplication. Now, this matrix, this identity matrix, is commutative distributive and associative with respect to multiplication. With respect to multiplication. What I mean to say is that if I have an identity matrix given by this I, then A, I into B, all of them are matrices of corresponding dimension so that they can be multiplied together. This is equal to IAB. This is equal to AIB, ABI, and that is equal to AB, because if you multiply some matrix with an identity matrix, you'll be having the same value, AB. So this is the property pertaining to the identity matrix. Now we have another type of matrix, which is known to be an orthogonal matrix. Let us quickly revisit what is meant by orthogonal matrix. Orthogonal matrix. Now, obviously, it's a square matrix. That means it must belong to this set up to the power n cross n. Now, this is known to be orthogonal matrix if and if, only if its columns are orthonormal, so that I could have A into A transpose is equal to A transpose into A is equal to the identity matrix. That means A transpose is equal to the A inverse. Although we have not discussed what is inverse matrix. In fact, if I have two matrices A and B, as you know, and if the product, if A and B, their product gives you the identity matrix, then one matrix is known to be the inverse of the other. For example, if I consider this matrix A like this, say minus 1, 0 and 0, 1, you can easily find out the corresponding transpose operation, A transpose. In fact, the transpose being the same, minus 1, 0 and 0, 1. And if you find out the product of these two matrices, A and A transpose, after calculation, you will find that minus 1 will give you 1, 0, 0 will give you 0, and then it will be something like that, 1, 0, 0, 1. So it's an identity matrix. That is I, 2 cross 2. So therefore, it's an orthogonal matrix. Now, after discussing this one, let me quickly revisit what is the determinants of matrix, which is given by this determinants. Let me quickly revisit this one. So for calculating this one, determinants of matrix. Now consider square matrix, so A, which belongs to this particular set n cross n. Now the determinant is given by, or is symbolically is represented by this particular symbol. This is known to be the determinant of this particular matrix, determinant A. Now to find out the determinant, first of all, we need to find out the cofactor of the square matrix A. This cofactor is given by cofactor for an order n cross n square matrix. So this cofactor is given by square matrix A. Let it be some R comma S. So this is nothing but minus 1 to the power R plus S and ARS. What is this ARS? ARS is nothing but the matrix which is formed by deleting the row number R and column number S of the matrix. So this is nothing but the matrix derived from the main matrix A. From the main matrix after deleting row A, row number R, row R, row number R, and column number S. This is also called the minor of A. Now let us take an example to understand this one, to find out the determinants of any matrix. Let us take an example. So the matrix is given by this. So 1, 3, so let it be 2, so 4, 5, 6, let me change it like 8, 7, 9. This is the matrix. So first of all, you need to find out the cofactor. How does it look like, this cofactor? So to find out the cofactor, you have to delete the corresponding row and corresponding column. So whenever you are here, the first row, first column, so this column and this row has to be deleted, and you have this 5, 6, 7, 9 only. And take a look at the sign. Since 1, 1, so 1 plus 1 will be 2. So minus 1 to the power 2, so it will be plus 1. So 5, 6, 7, 9. In the next one, delete this one. What we have? We have 4, 6, and 8, 9. And for the third one, we have 4, 5, and 8, 7. This completes the first row. Now in the second row, the first element will be minus, because second row first column, so it will be 3 minus 1 to the power 3 will be minus 1. So you have 3, 2, 7, 9. Then the next element will be positive. It will be like 1, 2, and 8, 9. And the final element is negative, because second row and third column, so 2 plus 3, 5. So 1, 3, 8, 7. And coming back to the last element, I mean the last, first element of the last column, last row, we have 3, 2, 5, 6. Then you have minus n over here, 1, 2, 4, 6, and ultimately this one, 1, 3, 4, 5. If you calculate the determinants, ultimately, what do we have? So let me calculate one by one. So this will become 545. And 42 here, so 3. So then we have for this 36 and 48. So 12, next one 12. This element will be 28 and 40, that is minus 12. Here we have 27, and then we have 14. So 13 with a negative sign outside, so minus 13. 9, 16, 7, minus 7, 7 and 24, 17, plus 17, 18 and 10, 18 and 10, so it will become 8, and then you have 6 minus 8, it is minus 2, minus minus 2, plus 2, and we have 5 minus 12, that is minus 7. So this is the cofactor. We have calculated the cofactor for the matrix A. Now this cofactor will be used to find out the adjoint of a matrix. So to find out the inverse of a matrix, as you know, the formula for inverse is nothing but the adjoint A by determinant A. Now the inverse of a matrix, the formula is, for the calculation of inverse of a matrix A is given by other matrix B, for which A into B is the identity matrix. So in that case, I can say that B is nothing but A inverse. And this is given by adjoint A by determinant A. This is the formula, well-known formula, perhaps you know, you have studied this one in your mathematics course. So what is this adjoint? So this is adjoint A, this is the adjoint of the matrix. In short, it is written like ADJ. Adjoint of a matrix A. So this is nothing but this adjoint A, the cofactors we have already calculated, and adjoint is simply the matrix of cofactors transposed. So already have computed this theta, so to find out this theta transpose. Otherwise, I can write like this, minus 1 whole to the power r plus s. And then you have this one, a r comma s whole transpose. And already we have discussed what is this a r s. This is nothing but the matrix formed after deleting the row number r and column number s of the matrix. And inverse of the matrix is found by this particular formula. Now pertaining to this inverse operation, let us take a look at some of the properties which the inverse of any matrix possesses. So let us take a look at some of the properties. The first property is that A into A inverse is equal to the A inverse into A is equal to I, the identity matrix, and this A inverse is unique. That means the inverse of a matrix is unique. On the other hand, in order to calculate the inverse of a matrix, A must be square, as you know. A must be a square matrix, but it is not necessary condition for this one. To have inverse of any matrix always. What is the condition? So that we'll be having an inverse from a matrix, the condition is that the determinant A must be non-zero. Because if you just take a look at the formula over here, this is adjoint A by determinant A. So if determinant A becomes zero, so under this condition, which is known to be the condition of singularity, since under this condition, you don't have the inverse matrix. So A has to be square, this is the necessary condition, but not the sufficient condition. Now in that case, when the inverse of a matrix does not exist, when this determinant A equal to zero, it is known to be a singular condition. And on the other hand, if I apply this inverse operation twice, as you understand, A inverse will be getting the same matrix back. Not twice, I should repeat that. You can operate this one even number of times. Then you'll be getting the same matrix together back again. And similarly, just like a transpose operation, it can also be shown that if I have two matrices like A and B, then their inverse is given by B inverse into A inverse. And the last property is that if I have a transpose and if I have an inverse operation on the transpose matrix, this is same as the transpose of the inverse. So these are some of the properties pertaining to the inverse of any matrix. Now our discussion pertaining to this matrix is almost over. Now we will be talking about something regarding the solving the system of equations, obviously using the matrix notation. Otherwise, this discussion will be incomplete. Now, let us move to the next part of our discussion, that is solving the system of equations using matrix notation, solving systems of equation. So in many of the cases, you'll find a number of linear equations which needs to be solved. And as you know, using matrix formulation, we can very easily find out a solution. So I believe that that part is already well known to you, but still, for the sake of completeness, let me very briefly touch upon that. Suppose I would like to have, say, three variables over here, x, y, and z, and there are three equations, three linear equations, and I'd like to solve them. We have three equations like this, involving three variables like x plus 2y plus z is equal to, say, 3. And then we have 3x, say, minus y minus 3z equal to, say, minus 1. The second equation. The third one is 2x plus 3y plus z equal to, say, let it be 4. So I need to solve x and y and z from this. So you know the well-known method to solve it out. So we need to extract these coefficients first. So we have 3 minus 1 minus 3, 2, 3, 1. So the system equations can be represented as a matrix multiplication. Then you have this vector, column vector x, y, z. This will give me the output, that is 3, minus 1, and 4. So equivalently, this is nothing but, so if I regard this one, this as a matrix A, this as a vector X, and this as a vector, let it be, say, B. Then I can write this one as A into X equal to B. What I need to find? I need to find X out of it, because these are the variables, unknown variables, X, Y, and Z. So from that, it's quite apparent that X is equal to A inverse into B. So once you know to solve the inverse of any matrix, you can very easily find it out, the inverse of any matrix. And once you get the inverse, as I've already mentioned, to calculate the inverse, we need to find out the adjoint part and then the determinant part. and the ratio of these two will give you the inverse operation. The obvious condition is that the determinant must be non-zero. Otherwise, this inverse will not exist at all. And in which case we say that the matrix is a singular matrix. Otherwise, for non-zero determinant of the matrix A, we can always find out A inverse. And if I find out the product of this A inverse with B, I can easily find out this vector consisting of X, Y, and Z. So it's all about the system equations, or solving system equations, which perhaps you know it very well. Now, very briefly, let me touch upon another concept. I don't know whether this is known to you or not. However, in my discussion, I have already make a note of that these are the different things, vectors and matrices, systems of linear equations. And so these two parts has already been discussed today in this particular lecture. And this derivation of regression line will be discussed in tomorrow's lecture. There will be a separate session on regression analysis and covariance matrix. So hopefully this third and fourth will be discussed in tomorrow's lecture, afternoon lecture. And so then I have planned to keep the support vector machine and dimension reduction in some of the later lectures in this particular course. So only one part is left, that is the convolution. And I don't know, might be a feature from, I don't know whether you know it, this convolution operation, but hopefully if you are from say electronics electrical background, hopefully you might be knowing what is convolution, but it is my responsibility to tell what is meant by convolution operation. So convolution, so let me write it down. Perhaps you know it, some of you, if not all. So convolution operation. So convolution is basically operation between two signals. So I don't know what you, if you understand what is meant by signal or not. But anyway, I can represent them by means of matrix notation only, a vector notation only, then you can understand it clearly. Suppose I am having two vectors like this. Suppose there is one vector x, which is given by, say, for example, say 1, 2, and say -3. This is one vector, for example. And let me have another vector. The dimension might be different. It can be different. Suppose this one is given by, say, 1 and -1. And I would like to find out the convolution between these two signals. So here, the signals are regarded by means of vectors. So the convolution operation will give us output. Let it be H. This is given by X. This is the symbol of convolution. A star in between the two operands, X star Y. Now, in fact, this convolution operation deals with four basic operations. Now, what are those four basic operations? So, in case of convolution, we do have four basic operations, like we have operation like folding. We have operation like shifting. Then we have operation like multiplication and the final operation is addition. Now, since I'm talking with respect to the vectors, and which we have discussed few minutes back in this particular lecture, so I think this last two operation, multiplication, additional. So sorry, I think I made a mistake over there. It should be addition. Anyway, so I think these two operations have been already discussed in this particular lecture, this multiplication and addition. But I think these two operations are new to you, the folding and shifting. What do you mean by folding and what do you mean by shifting? So to find out the folding operation, or to find out the result after the folding operation. So let us assume that there is a mirror. So this, there is 1, 2, minus 3. These are the three values, 1, 2, and minus 3. And suppose there is a mirror placed over here. And what you observe on the other side of the mirror will give you the folded signal. So x is 1, 2, minus 3. And if I would like to have the folded version of that, is x fold, if I write like this, x of f, this x of f is nothing but we have minus 3 first, then we have 2, and then you have 1. This is the folded version. And shifting means what? Shifting means you are initially this 1 and 1, so they are corresponding to the first element. So if I regard this as a vector, so this is the first row, first column. So 1, 1, this will be 1, 2, 1, 3. This is also 1, 1, this is 1, 2. 1, 3 is absent over here. Or you can also think that there is a 0 at the third position. So this is xf after folding. But while you have performed the folding operation, remember that the mirror is placed over here. So this is your original, this position. And we have y over here already, like this. One minus one. So y was placed over here like this. So after this folding operation, this is the organization of these two vectors, xf and y, the folded version and the original signal. In fact, then once it will be 0, so 0, 1, 2, it will be 0, minus 1, minus 2, like this. So I'm not going into the detailed mathematical derivations for convolution, although I will tell you at the end of this lecture, both in the continuous time and in the discrete time. But anyway, so if I would like to find out the convolved signal h, so first you just multiply the corresponding elements. You need to multiply the corresponding elements without any shifting. So initially we have folded the signal, fine. Now without shifting, you need to multiply. So since there is no element over here, so I can regard that there are zeros. So if you multiply these two, what will be the answer? And answer will be one only. So that is fine. The answer will be one. Now you just keep this one fixed. You keep this one fixed, y fixed, and you shift this one. Or rather, let me erase this one. Keep this one fixed. Y is fixed. I'm not changing the position of y. Y is fixed. And you are just you try to shift xf. If you try to shift xf, then after one round, it will be something like that. You have a minus 3 over here, 2 over here, and 1 over here. So once again, if you find out the product, you have 2 over here, and you have minus 1 over here. And then apart from multiplication, since we have two elements, so you need to add. So we have 2 over here, minus 1. So the result will be plus 1. So the result will be plus 1. And then after another round of shifting, it will come over here, minus 3, 2 over here, 1 over here. Now if you multiply this minus 3 with 1, you have minus 3. And you have 2 with minus 1, that is minus 2. If you add together, the result is minus 5. So the result is minus 5. Still you have overlapping. So then in the third phase, this minus 3 will be shifted over here. Then you have a situation like this, minus 3, 2, 1. So for 2 and 1, there is no corresponding element to multiply. So only have minus 3 over here. So this minus 3 is multiplied with minus 1. The result will be plus 3. So this is the final result, the convolved signal, 1, 1. Minus 5, 3. If you make any further attempt to shift the signal, you'll see that there is no overlapping, so the output will be 0. So there goes the rule. Now, if this particular signal or if this particular vector is having a dimension, say 1 cross m, and if this is having a dimension of say 1 cross n, then the resultant convolved signal will be having a dimension of 1 cross m plus n minus 1. 1 cross m plus n minus 1. So this is the discrete version of convolution, and we do have the continuous version as well, but since we are discussing about the matrix and vectors in this particular lecture, so intentionally I would not prefer to go into the continuous version because it might create a lot of confusion amongst you. So anyway, even if in the discrete version, I can write it down, the expression for the convolved signal. So the expression for the convolved signal is given by h of k, or rather h of n, is given by the discrete version. I can write like this, x of k, and we do have another signal y of n minus k, where k is ranging from minus to plus infinity. So I'm allowing all the shifting over here. So initially you have the signal x of k, and this is also equivalent to, this is also equivalent to y of k and x of n minus k. Y of k, x of n minus k. That means this convolution operation, x convolved h, rather x convolved y, is equal to y convolved x. That means I can say that this convolution operation is commutative in nature. So a commutativity property holds good, and hopefully you can identify the different operations involved over here. Initially xk, we have the signal over here, or the vector over here, like xk, the signal I can regard as a signal. With the people from electronics background, we prefer to call it signal, but if you wish, you can also call it like a vector, because we can regard it as a signal or vector, same thing. I formulated the vector like a signal, like a vector. And similarly, the same is true for y of k, the original signal, in fact. Both of them are signal. Now, what about y of minus k? This is nothing but the folded signal, folded vector, minus k, because folded vector. It's better to remove the term signal because it might create confusion. Many of you might not be aware about signal, so it's better to make it like a vector, folded vector, y of minus k. So then what is y of n minus k? So this is the shifted and folded. So y of n minus k is shifted and folded. So already we have incorporated these two operations, folding and shifting, over here. And we do have multiplication operation quite apparent over here, since we are multiplying these two together. And ultimately, outside we have this summation. So all four operations are involved within this particular equation. Summation x of k, y of n minus k, or y of k of x of n minus k, k ranging from minus to plus infinity. And the result is obtained for a particular value of shift. For a particular n, you are getting this hn. For example, this is for no shift, the first value. This is for no shift. This is for one shift. This is for two shift. This is for three shift. So this is for n0, n1, n2, n3. So this is all about the convolution. And in continuous domain, so I'm not going into that. In continuous domain, everything is remaining same. The only difference is that instead of addition, you should have the integration operation over here, because if you have discrete elements which can be represented or regarded as a vector, that is not true for a continuous variable, which will vary continuously over a range of time or any independent variable. So instead of having a summation over here, we do have an integration sign, and obviously it will be integrated with respect to some variable. So that is the only change, which might be over here for a continuous convolution. However, I think we should be happy with the discrete convolution, because to understand the concept of convolution is much more easier in discrete domain rather than in continuous domain. Anyway, so I think the regression and this covariance analysis, I think that can be covered tomorrow in a lecture. With this, let me conclude this lecture on linear algebra.